One, as often is the case during Lent, and historically was the case during Lent, it is the season we prepare the confirmands to be received by the bishop, to be confirmed or received by the bishop. So if you are not part of the youth group, the middle school youth group, who are going to confirmation class, and all the eighth graders in that youth group will be confirmed, but you are eighth grade or older and would like to be confirmed or received into the Episcopal Church, please see me as we will start classes in the coming weeks. Other things going on in the life of the church. Before we can dive into Lent, we have to celebrate. We have to have one last hurrah, and that will take place Tuesday, Shrove Tuesday. We'll celebrate with pancakes, with rice and beans, and festivities here at on Tuesday between 5:30 and 7. And then we begin Ash Wednesday on Wednesday with a noon service or a 7 p.m. service. So we hope to see all of you there for the imposition of ashes. And before I go on to the rest of the announcements, in order to deepen your Lenten journey, Randolph's going to tell us about some of our formation offerings that might help you.
Thank you, Ben. And I'd like for John Pierce to come forward, please. As I prepare for John, I hope all of you have one of these inserts that also have been mailed out. They also are on the website. Check the website for everything that's going on because there's a lot of information there. So, during Lent, we're going to study this book called The Last Week. It's looking at the last week of Jesus in Jerusalem, and it follows the gospel according to Mark. It's a fascinating book. If you look at the front page of the insert, of the handout, it's got a little description there, and it also talks about learning groups. We have two learning groups on Sundays, one at 9:15, one at 11:45. There's a learning group that meets with the women. There are about three men that meet also with the Tuesday group at 10:30, and five couples, right, that are in your home learning group, and would you tell us about that, please?
Okay, well, it's not my group. My supposed friends in the group nominated me to be the one to stand up here because I think they think I love them. Actually, Lee and Terry Owsley had the idea to organize based on a book group that the wives had already sort of set up. And they said, well, wouldn't it be great to invite the husbands and let's do this Bible study? And as you can imagine, I'm sure all the husbands were like, yes. It actually been very fun. We've had a good time. We get to drink wine. That's always a good thing, which you can't do on Sunday mornings. But we've gone through. We've been faithful, meeting every week to go through the book. I will tell you, because they nominated me to talk, and I can say anything I want, the majority of this group wasn't a big fan of this last book, but we're really looking forward to the next one to be a little bit more...
Fantastic.
Yeah. Hopefully the print will be bigger, too.
The print will be bigger, and yeah, this last book had a lot of big words in it, It was very dense. But this is a great example because not everybody can meet on Sunday or Tuesday mornings, and if you meet with some of your friends, you may be in a home, it's a great way. Small groups is a way that congregations really can move deeper into the faith, and they're doing a great job. Ask them if you have any more questions about it. So, please participate in our Lenten activities. It is a way for us to move deeper into that truth of the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Thank you. And this week, in our weekly series talking about our capital campaign, I want to share some good news with you. In the month of February, we not only received approval of our SUP, I know all these acronyms now, our special use permit, which is critical to us moving forward with the project from the town council. And then this week, we had our plans approved for our certificate of appropriateness, our COA, from the ARB, the Architectural Review Board. if you want to see the church have a bright future, I can think of two no more critical things to the vitality and future life of the church than having adequate space and accessibility for our programming and for all of our members and for providing financial assurance that we will have the resources to be able to continue to do vibrant ministry into the future. So for some of you, you can give very generously to the capital campaign on April 2nd, knowing that you have 3 years to make that pledge. You can very capably make a pledge. And then you might also be able to make a gift to a planned gift down the road in your will to the endowment. For some of you, you may not have the flexibility now to make the kind of gift you'd like to make to the capital campaign, but you might really take a look at the possibility of making a planned gift down the road, knowing that will help as well and lay those important stones for a sure foundation for our future. So this is a little information about our endowment. One of the things the endowment committee has been working very hard on, you heard a little bit about it at the annual meeting, is the Omega file. Sadly, I've had to be with two families in the past week as they've dealt with the loss of a loved one. And one of the things that the Omega file will allow folks to do is to be able to know funeral intentions, financial intentions, where all of the accounts and keys and important things are. It is a comprehensive file of all the things that a loved one would want to know and be able to gracefully care for a loved one in those last days of life and after death. So we'll let you know more about it when it goes online, but it should go online this week or next. But also on the back of this sheet is what a confidential estate gift declaration form looks like. And this is, you can fill this out or receive another copy of this. But this is a form that if you've already made arrangements in your will for the church, you can fill this out, and then your monies will be included in that gift of or that goal of $500,000 for this campaign. So, and if you want to know anything else about the endowment or just how you might be able to do that, there's at the exits there are planned gifts brochures or Barry Hamilton or Bob Macedo are a wealth of knowledge, but we are very cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and wait there, and I will give you the tablets of stone with the law and the commandment, which I have written for their instruction." So Moses set out with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of God. To the elders, he had said, "Wait here for us until we come to you again, for Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute may go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. On the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. Moses was on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, reading from the second letter of Peter. We did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we had been eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received honor and glory from God the Father when that voice was conveyed to him by the majestic glory, saying, "This is my Son, my beloved, with whom I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this voice come from heaven while we were with him on the holy mountain. So we have the prophetic message more fully confirmed. You will do well to be attentive to this as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. First of all, you must understand this. No prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's own interpretation, because no prophecy ever came by human will, but men and women moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Dwellings here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, "This is my son, the beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." When they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be good in your sight. Amen. God is a loving God. He is the God of love. God is love. God sent his only begotten Son so that we would understand the nature of God is love. Many of you know that I spent most of January in a country called Myanmar. Traveling the country, we met with many of our brothers and sisters there that were part of the Anglican Communion, part of our Anglican brothers and sisters. Burma, or Myanmar, is a country that is majority Buddhist, about 90%. Of that population in Myanmar, Christians make up 5 to 7%. And of that 5 to 7, the Anglican Communion there is just a fraction. During that experience, I had a number of life-changing events. That's easy to say, but it's true. We traveled the country. We met people. I even had a chance to preach in a small church in the middle of the jungle, in a place that didn't even have a road to get there. Amazing. I preached in a church barefoot and in a skirt. That's for another sermon. While I was there, we had the opportunity to meet with a number of parishes and diocesan leaders. One of the first locations we went to was in a state called Paan. Sorry. And in Paan, we had a sit-down, town hall type of a meeting where we all sat at the front, and the church leaders talked about what it meant to be Christian. They wanted to hear from us, to hear what it meant to be Christian. Our specific discussion topic was, what does it mean to be Christian in a country where Christians are the minority? It was a great, great conversation for the entire time that we were there. But there was one question that a young man asked. He stood up and proclaimed his gospel. He stood up and said, "I am Christian, even though many of my friends ask me, how could I worship a God that is supposed to be all about love, but somehow is so jealous and petty, he won't let me worship other gods?" I'm not in Kansas anymore. I'm not in Northern Virginia or the U.S. or a place where a monotheistic God is a given. How do I answer that question? All right, so we're going to change the scene now. Let's talk about the gospel. Our gospel today is one that we've all heard. We all know this story, right? But this is a story that's being told in a context where a monotheistic God is not guaranteed, where a monotheistic God is not the norm. We hear the story 100 times. Jesus took Peter, James, and John up the mountain by themselves. Jesus was transfigured right before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. Moses and Elijah appeared. Then they were overcome by a bright cloud overshadowed them, and God spoke. When the disciples heard it, they fell to their faces and were greatly afraid. Jesus came to them, touched them, and said, "Arise and do not be afraid." And when they lifted their heads, they saw that no one there but Jesus, Jesus alone. So when I looked at this passage, I wondered, why this passage, why this story right here in the book of Matthew? Why is it placed? Because we know it's always placed where it's supposed to be. I think that the story is based in the context of that place in where this monotheistic God is not a guarantee. In the previous chapter, in 16, we read that people are asking the question, "Who is Jesus?" When they asked, Jesus responded, "Who do you say that I, the Son of Man, am?" Well, the disciple replied, "Some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." Even his own disciples were asking the question, "Who is Jesus? Why is Jesus special?" Jesus responds with a question, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answers, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." If it hadn't been hot gossip in town, this wouldn't be an issue. We wouldn't be talking about it right now, but it obviously was. So in chapter 16, we hear the human response. Chapter 17 is the divine response. God the Father wanted to answer the question, "Who is he and why is he special?" This lectionary comes, or this story comes in our lectionary as we finish out Epiphany. That's not a mistake. The story shows us the true nature of Christ as both divine and human, human and divine. At the Transfiguration, Jesus appears and he is transformed. Elijah and Moses appear on the mountain, and God the Father spoke to the disciples. And all of this was part of the Father's response, "Who is Jesus?" Moses and Elijah represent the law and the promise to our forefathers. Moses and Elijah disappear, and Jesus alone remained. One Bible commentary put it this way, "The law and the prophets have served their turn and pass away. He who is the fulfillment of both alone remains." Why Jesus? A new era is on the horizon. The old covenant, represented by Moses and Elijah, are going to pass away, and the new covenant is coming through the death and the resurrection of Christ. The new covenant is a relationship with Jesus. So how do I answer that young man in the village on the other side of the world, that young man that struggles with this question, why Jesus? At the Transfiguration, God the Father and God the Son showed us who Jesus is. And suddenly the voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Hear him." The disciples were terrified, faces to the ground, their faces ground because they were to the ground because they were humbled by the divine. But Jesus came over to them and touched them. They were comforted not by the divine, but by his humanity. God, the divine nature, could have just said, "Get up, don't be afraid." But God, the Son, went to them, touched them. I imagine touching them on the shoulder, comforting them. And when they looked, they saw only Jesus. God the Father spoke, "This is my Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear him." Why Jesus? God the Father did not say, "Listen to Jesus and Moses and Elijah." God the Father's final word was, "Listen to Jesus." So what do you think? Why Jesus? How would you answer that young man on the other side of the world in a context so removed from our own? How would you answer that young man? I spent a lot of time thinking about that. This is what I think. God does not tell us to stop loving other gods because he is jealous, but rather because in some way that is beyond our ability to comprehend, in some way that is beyond science to prove, in some way that theologies of fancy theologians cannot explain, God is love. Why Jesus? Because God the Father sent his only Son, begotten, not made, to show us the love of God. He sent his only Son, who was both human and divine, to guide us to an understanding of God, to God's true nature. God is love. Amen.
Let's stand and face the cross and confirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, life from life, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit. He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
With all our hearts and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord, singing, "Lord, have mercy." For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, Shannon, Susan, and Ted, our bishops, Ben and Randolph, our clergy, Jeff and Selden, our seminarians, for St. James Episcopal Church and School, for all the clergy and people, let
really important thing for you all to have. It's difficult to raise your hand and say, I might need some help, or I'm having trouble dealing with some of these challenges. And you may sit around and think, well, certainly somebody else's problems are more important than mine. And that's not true. Stephen Ministry has affected me personally in a number of different ways. I've been a Stephen Minister since 2003. I became Stephen Leader in 2010. So theoretically, right, I've been involved in the program on the Stephen Minister side for many, many years. But about a little over a year ago, I had some challenges in my own life. That roller coaster that we all go through. In the course of about 6 months, my mother had some very serious health concerns, almost died 3 times. My father died, sent my oldest daughter off to college, had some challenges at work, all in a 6-month time period. And I'd like to say I'm a big, strong man and I can handle it, but I couldn't. So I went to my good friend, my church wife, soon to be my other friend, and I said, you know what, I think it's time I need to see. My Stephen Minister has been a savior in my life. And, you know, he meets with me once a week and just lets me talk and lets me express what's on my heart. And that's so important. You know, I have friends and I have family. I have a lovely wife. I can tell her anything. But, you know, your friends and your family, when you're going through these journeys, they're going through those journeys with you. Okay? They're experiencing some of the same things you are. Sometimes it's really difficult for them to help you because they're having to help themselves. You know, if you ever ride on an airplane, right? They say, put the mask on you first before you help somebody next to you. It's the same way in your life when you're going through journeys. So that's my story. That's how Stephen Ministry has helped me. You know, and what's great about it is none of you knew that until I just told you, because my Stephen Minister keeps everything confidential. Now, it's okay for me to say it. Now, of course, he can't, so don't go and try to figure out who he is. But he takes it so seriously, he deletes my text after I text him, just in case somebody might look at his phone. So if you're sitting out there and you're going through one of those journeys in your life, and you think, I might need somebody to talk to, come see me or Sue. Joanna is in the back here. Joanna, maybe you can come up. Joanna's going to go to leadership training here in April. And she will help out as well. Of course, you can see Father Ben or Father Randolph. You can even call Nancy. She's also a trained Stephen minister. Or any of the other Stephen ministers that might be present amongst you. So if you're a Stephen minister right now, please stand.
Current
Stephen ministers, please stand.
effective servants of Christ. Are you prepared to meet this request?
Yes, with the help of God.
We also ask you to accept their ministry when you need help, to allow these individuals to work with you as you face struggles in your life, that you might receive support and to help from your Christian brothers and sisters. If you are prepared to meet this request, answer yes with the help of God.
Yes, with the help of God.
Stephen Ministers, are you prepared to serve as Stephen Ministers at St. James?
Yes, with the help of God.
May you share Christ's ever abundant. joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Give us this day our daily bread, and
thanksgiving. us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. You have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Remember that life is short. We have too little time to gladden the hearts of those who travel away with us. So be quick to be kind. Make haste to love. May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you